Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Duchess, a novel of Sarah Churchill, by Susan Holloway Scott, narrated by Heather Wilds. Prologue. St. James's Palace, London, November 1688. It is no easy trick to overthrow the King of England. One must be blessed with courage and conviction, a dash of recklessness and passion beyond measure. And in my prime, on the night I helped my friend the Princess Anne escape, I do believe I had all that and more. I needed every bit of it too. I was staying at St. James's Palace in the lodgings of my brother-in-law, the Earl of Tyrconnell. And because he and my sister were gone to Ireland, I was alone in the apartment save for the servants. I had just finished dressing for the day, my pearls still cool against my throat, when one of the maids burst into my bedchamber, tears in her eyes and her apron knotted in her hands.
"Oh, my lady, there's soldiers at the door,"
she cried, her voice shrill with panic.
"They called General Lord Churchill a traitor, and they say they must see you at once."
I hooked the last pearl through my ear before I answered, determined to be calm. I'd known the king's soldiers would come. There'd never been any doubt. My four children were safe with friends in the country in preparation. Our estates as secured as they could be. Yet though my heart raced within my breast, I would not turn flighty and fearful, but instead do as John and I had planned. "The soldiers may say what they please about his lordship," I said, as I rose from my dressing table and shook out my skirts. "We know the truth. I shall see the officers in the parlour." I waited upstairs until the men had been shown into the parlour, and then I waited a little longer, to give them time to consider their actions against my husband and me. By most lights, neither John nor I would seem the sort to be arrested as traitors to the crown. John had served in His Majesty's household and in his army since he'd been a boy, rising from a mere page to a lieutenant general, his accomplishments acknowledged with the title of Baron Churchill of Sandridge. Although I was still a young woman, not yet 30, I had lived in the eye of the court for nearly 15 years. I'd begun as a maid of honour to the Duchess of York before she'd become queen, and now I served as mistress of the bedchamber to Anne, the Princess of Denmark, and His Majesty's younger daughter. John and I had been well rewarded for our loyalty, and we were wise enough to appreciate our good fortune. But to the sorrow of the country, James Stuart had again and again proved himself unworthy of the throne he had inherited from his brother, Charles II. He had silenced the voice of the people by dismissing Parliament. He had chosen to serve his own Roman faith and be guided by the Pope to the fear and the detriment of his own Anglican country. And he had vowed to make Catholicism again the state religion. He had imprisoned the Archbishop of Canterbury and other leaders of the Anglican Church in the Tower and charged them with seditious libel. Worst of all, he had replaced Protestant leaders in the government, the army, and the navy with Papist Frenchmen, letting poor England be pushed towards the greedy, grasping hands of our great enemy, King Louis of France. James's actions left no recourse for any Englishman who cared both for his country and his faith. And so my husband and I, and many others, had turned to the Protestant Mary Stuart, James's older daughter and the Princess of Orange, and her husband William, for deliverance, and meant to put them on the English throne in James's place. Yet as I walked slowly down the stairs, I could not help but think how irrevocable each step might be. My husband and I had together agreed that this was the right course to take for our consciences. But the risk was fearsome indeed. If the rebellion failed, retribution would be swift for those who had supported it. We would forfeit all our property and estates, and have our titles and privileges stripped from us. We would be imprisoned in the Tower until tried, and when, not if, we were convicted, we would be beheaded for all the world to watch. The only legacy we would leave for our little son and three daughters would be poverty and disgrace. And as for the poor innocent babe I now carried within my womb, why, I could not even guarantee birth and life, or the eternal salvation of a Christian baptism. The lieutenant waiting for me in the parlor was very young and respectful. So young, he flushed like a girl when I greeted him. That was the power not only of my rank, but of my beauty as well, displayed to best effect in a rich green velvet gown with deep cuffs of Venetian lace. He wore the yellow coat of the old Duke of York's regiment, the first with which my John had served too. "So what has brought you here with your men, lieutenant?" I asked, smiling. I wished to put him at his ease, the better to coax from him whatever news he might know. "I don't believe you've come simply to ask after my health."
"No, my lady."
He took a deep breath and looked down at the floor, shying away from my gaze, the way most people do when bearing ill tidings.
"My orders are to confine you here to Lord Tyrconnel's lodgings, my lady, and to admit no one other than your servants."
"Am I to know the reason, lieutenant?" I asked lightly, for John had warned me to pretend as little knowledge as possible. "An officer and six of his men seem quite excessive for the care of one lone baroness."
"No, my lady." At last he did raise his gaze to meet mine. "I regret that I must inform you that your husband, General Lord Churchill, has betrayed His Majesty in the most grievous manner possible. Yesterday, His Lordship and His Majesty George, the Prince of Denmark, fled to the camp of William, Prince of Orange, at Axminster."
Speechless with surprise, I felt my knees weaken beneath me, and I dropped into the nearest chair. Of course, I'd known that John had planned to go to William once the prince had landed on English soil, but not so soon as this. He was supposed to have sent me word, a sign, so that the Princess Anne and I could have left London first, to be safely with our husbands and beyond the king's reach. But no word had come. And now I was left with soldiers to watch me close as a hungry cat at a mouse's hole in the wainscoting. The lieutenant hurried to my side, bending on one knee beside my chair.
"I am most sorry, my lady, very sorry," he said, his voice full of the hand-wringing helplessness that young men seem to feel when confronted with an unhappy woman. "Shall I send for your maid, my lady?" I shook my head, gathering my wits as well as my courage. At least I knew now that John was safe. I could take comfort in that. And I would be strong. I must be strong, for John's sake, as well as our children's.
"You say Lord Churchill has been denounced as a traitor. Does that mean you have come to arrest me for the sin of being his wife?"
The lieutenant hesitated.
"No, my lady, those are not my orders."
But the words "not yet" hung between us, unspoken yet understood. I would have to act as swiftly as I could.
"Might you tell me this, lieutenant?" I asked. "How many other officers and lords have gone with Lord Churchill to Axminster?"
The young man hesitated, his fingers working nervously over the pommel of his sword, being all the answer I needed to my question. The rebellion was succeeding. And fast. John had guessed that support would be strong in the army and in the navy, and that the great lords, too, would reject James and choose William in his place. Thank God he'd been right.
"They say the king means to hold fast here in London, my lady,"
the lieutenant said instead, freely giving me what I would have begged next.
"They say he's on the road now, with 2,000 of his most loyal troops. But as long as you remain here, my lady, following His Majesty's orders, you will be safe."
Oh yes, I was safe, I thought with grim certainty. As safe as any prisoner locked away in a cell. But this young man's opinion was of little consequence. My duty next was to rescue the princess. I drew my handkerchief from my cuff, dabbing it weakly at my temples.
"You are most kind to watch over me, lieutenant,"
I whispered, making my voice faint.
"These are troubled times, and I will feel much safer with you and your men here."
He puffed out his chest beneath his green sash, the little cockerel. "No harm will come to you while we watch over you, my lady."
"Thank you," I said tremulously. "I will be sure to give orders to the cook that you and your men are to have whatever you wish to fortify yourselves for your duty."
That's not necessary, my lady, he said, though I guessed he'd be the first at the kitchen table when the joint was pulled from the spit.
Oh, but it is,
I said, my gratitude as cloyingly sweet as May honey.
It is. Yet I fear I must ask a small favor of you, in turn. You say I am not allowed to leave here.
He frowned. Those are my orders, my lady.
But you see, Lieutenant, I have an appointment that must take me from this part of the palace.
I hesitated, as if from modesty.
I am with child, and I was to call upon my midwife to consult about...
You may go, my lady, he said hastily, his expression every bit as squeamish and discomfited as I'd expected. You have my leave for that small freedom, but you must give your word that you'll return. A half hour later, I was hurrying across St. James's Park towards Princess Anne's quarters in the cockpit at Whitehall, the oldest part of the royal palace. I took care not to draw attention to myself, wearing a plain dark woolen cloak with the fur-lined hood drawn up and my head bowed, and a black scarf wrapped over my face as if against the chill November air. I entered Whitehall, not by the front hall, where there were sure to be more of the king's soldiers, but through the apartments I kept in the cockpit below the princess's, for the times when I attended her. In the summer, when the first hints of a rebellion had risen, John had urged the princess to have a tiny back staircase constructed between our bedchambers, secret to all but us, and now I made good use of it.
Oh, you've come! You've come!
Cried the princess, as soon as she saw me at the staircase's door. I tried to curtsy, as was fit, but she was too distraught for ceremony, and instead grabbed my hands and pulled me upright.
My dear, have you heard?
She cried, throwing herself into my arms and blurring the difference in our ranks, as she often did with me.
The Prince and Lord Churchill have gone to William and left us behind. Oh, God help us! Whatever are we to do?
That's why I've come, Your Highness, I said, disentangling myself so I might look at her squarely. She was trembling, her doughy face even more pale than usual with fear, and I spoke slowly to calm her, the way one would with a terrified child.
We will solve this together. Where are your other ladies? They're in the parlour, with the Queen,
she said, belatedly lowering her voice so she wouldn't be heard.
I came here to use my closet, but what can we do? How can we get away now, with my father returning to London? I would rather throw myself from the window than have him find me here.
Her voice broke into a sob, and I slipped my arm around her shoulder. She knew what was at stake as well as I. While her father had fallen into Romish ways, she had been raised as good an Anglican as any woman in the country, a decision that was a long-standing torment to the king. But it wasn't only her father's wrath that she feared. If William succeeded in seizing the English crown, then Anne would become second in the succession after her sister Mary. She would be a great prize for each side to possess. The sooner she could be taken to safety in William's camp, the better. That had always been planned for me by John and the others, my special assignment, to spirit Anne away from the palace. Oh, how fast it would break the king's heart and spirit to see both his daughters turned against him.
What shall we do?
Anne asked again in a helpless wail.
What will become of us?
Pray, listen to me, Your Highness, I said, my voice soft and urgent. We had known each other for many years, since we'd been girls, that I understood the times when she needed me more as a friend than as an attendant. You must retire to your bed early tonight and lock your bedchamber door so no others can enter. I have already sent word to Bishop Compton, and he has promised to...
The bishop will help us!
Her eyes lit with hope. Lord Henry Compton was not only the Bishop of London, but also Anne's preceptor and adviser, and the cleric who had presided at her wedding to Prince George. The bishop had been forced into hiding for his criticism of the king, but I had known where to find him, and known too that he would risk his own life for the princess and our cause. He and I, and Lord Dorset too, will return later this night for you, Your Highness, I said, reciting our careful plan. We'll have a hired coach waiting on the other side of the park, near Charing Cross. I'll come for you again myself, up the back stairs, and lead you away. Then we'll journey to Lord Dorset's house in Epping Forest for the night.
What if we meet my father's soldiers on the road? What if we are stopped? What if?
His Majesty is coming from the west, I said. If we leave with haste tonight, we should outpace them. She gasped with wonder.
Oh, my dear, you have it to every detail.
Because we cannot afford any detail to go astray, Your Highness, I said firmly. You must say nothing to anyone else, not to any of your ladies or servants, and you must bring nothing with you. Our escape must look sudden, unplanned, as if you'd been carried off against your will. She nodded slowly, her expression still taut with trepidation.
My father sent orders for you to be arrested for treason and taken to the Tower. I begged the Queen to stay them until tomorrow.
Even though I'd already suspected such an order would come for me, I felt the chill of it run through me, like a river of ice. When the King's nephew, the Duke of Monmouth, had tried to lead an earlier rebellion and failed, James had ordered all of us at court to watch the execution. It had taken 6 clumsy strikes of the axe to sever poor Monmouth's handsome head from his body. You could well have saved my life, Your Highness, I said slowly. However can I thank you for such a great favour?
It was no favour to you, Lady Churchill, but to me.
Her eyes filled with tears.
How could I ever risk losing you, my dearest friend?
I took her familiar hand in mine, her fingers heavy with her rings and her palm moist with fear. I risk everything for you, Your Highness, I said softly. We both know the dangers if we fail. Her mouth twisted, and I quickly offered her my own handkerchief.
So much danger!
She cried forlornly as she pressed the handkerchief to her eyes, then buried her face against my shoulder.
Oh, so much peril for me to bear!
I patted her plump shoulder, praying for both our sakes that tonight she'd find the strength to make good our escape. A royal princess can be the most selfish creature alive, cosseted and protected from the cradle to her grave. What would Anne know of perils or danger? If we were captured by her father, the very worst James would do to her would be to confine her to her rooms here at the palace, or hold back her allowance. For me, there'd be no mercy, and that certainly made my voice sterner than perhaps it should have been. Have courage, Your Highness, I said. We can't be weak now. We must be brave if we are to succeed. She lifted her face, her cheeks flushed and wet with tears of misery and fear.
I will try, she said contritely. I must trust you, as I always have when I've needed you. Now I must trust you again, for I have no other course.
I smiled and smoothed the lace scarf around her throat. You must trust me, because you are my dearest friend, too, Your Highness, I said, offering the gentle assurance she needed most to hear. We will be brave together, you and I, and because we have right on our side, we will succeed. Chapter 1. St. James's Palace, London. November, 1673. When I had been a tiny girl and living in the country near St. Albans, I had listened with rapt fascination to the stories my older sister Frances had told of her life at the court of King Charles II. Perhaps it was because we were poor for gentry that her stories seemed so dazzling. Or perhaps it was that the pall of England's recent sorrows still shadowed our lives in the debts my father could never escape. All too well, my parents recalled the grim rule of the Puritans, when Oliver Cromwell and the rest of his sour zealots had led England into 20 years of civil war and misery. They'd cut off the head of poor King Charles I and banned every merriment and pleasure as sinful,
and ruined the lives and fortunes of those who still remained loyal to the exiled royal family. But I was born in 1660, the week after Charles Stuart returned to England to reclaim his martyred father's throne, and for me, there was no other London than the one my sister described. Francis was 13 years older than I, and in the manner of little sisters, I breathlessly believed everything she told me. King Charles was the most handsome and glorious ruler ever to grace the throne. The ladies in his court were all great beauties, celebrated for their grace and charm. The gentlemen, to a man, were handsome, brave, and bold, and even the Palace of Whitehall itself rivaled every other such great house for grandeur and nobility. Oh, how eager I was to journey there too, and find my own place among so many splendors. But my path was not so easy, nor so grand. My father died the winter I was 8, and what little property he'd preserved passed to my older brother John. My sister Frances had long since wed Sir George Hamilton, and retired from court to the country with a growing family of her own. My mother and I were left with nothing but my father's debts. To keep us from the chill grip of Newgate, she had thrown herself upon the mercy of the king and secured lodgings for us within the protection of St. James's Palace, where no creditors could follow. I know that makes for a pretty tale, the resourceful widow and her daughter saved from disgrace to live in a palace, but I assure you, it was not half as grand as that. My mother had borne me so late in her fecundity that she'd always regarded me as an inconvenience and a hindrance, and age hadn't sweetened her temper. She was quick with blows if I crossed her or disobeyed, which only served to strengthen my natural spirit and resolve to make my own way apart from hers. Nor did the quality of our lodging lessen the ill feeling between us. We had our sanctuary from the bailiff, true, but it was far from the grand quarters of the court. Instead, we were like scores of others from around the kingdom, rewarded for our loyalty with the meanest of spaces in the distant corners of the palaces of St. James's and of Whitehall. My mother and I lived together in a single room near the stable yard, where despite the lack of a window, we were still assaulted by the racket of comings and goings, day and night, and the stench of manure and other offal. In this place, my mother took in worn smocks and other linens from the gentlewomen to mend towards our support. She had always been able to stitch a fine seam and fancy work, and tried to teach me the same. But I recognized this sorry education for what it was, training to be as subservient as she, and instead I labored to improve myself for greater things. Now I have heard that in the time of clever Queen Bess, 100 years before, ladies were encouraged to read and pass away at Latin like grey-beard scholars, but such an overwrought education was no longer the fashion. I learned to read tolerably well, yes, and write a pretty hand for letters, but ciphering and foreign tongues remained beyond my sphere. Yet who can fault me when there were so many other accomplishments to acquire that would bring me more favour? From the palace's galleries and in the park, I observed the court's grand ladies. I practiced their graceful walks and curtsies, and how best to hold my head and arrange an open fan in my hands. I learned to tell this duke from that earl, and which held more favour with the king. I washed my hair in honey water to preserve its golden colour, and I took care to keep my visage from the ravages of the sun. I saw how even the most beautiful and indulged mistress must give way to the plainest wedded lady, and I resolved that I would barter my maidenhead for marriage, and nothing less. And finally, directly before my 13th birthday, I was rewarded. I never knew why my mother's incessant applications on my behalf were finally answered. If I was honoured because of my sister's old place with the former Duchess of York, or because of my father's long-standing loyalty to His Majesty. Perhaps I'd simply been noticed while I walked in the park. I was a pretty child, and I knew it, with bright blue eyes, fair skin, and an upturned nose, and though not tall, I had a pleasingly confident carriage that made gentlemen turn and look after me with interest. That was the sum of my dowry, and I knew that too. Unlike other young girls with aspirations, I'd no grand family name or fortune to ease my way, nor a patron to sponsor me at court. All I knew to be certain was this. I had been called to the newlywed Mary Beatrice, Duchess of York, to be considered for a place as a maid of honour in her household. James, the Duke of York, was the king's only brother and heir, and the court he and the Duchess kept at St. James's was nearly the equal of His Majesty's across the park at Whitehall. To belong to the York's household would be splendid for me indeed. For the first time since I'd come to London, I proudly entered the palace beneath the tall brick towers built long before by the 8th King Henry. I wore my best gown, dark blue wool piped with yellow, with rows of tucks at the cuffs and hem of my petticoat to make up for the absence of more fashionable lace, which I could not yet afford. I held my head high and reminded myself that I'd been born into the gentry and that my father had once owned property in 3 counties. "My name is Miss Jennings," I said, showing the treasured letter to the porter who stopped me at the door. "I've come at the invitation of Her Grace, the Duchess of York." The man scarce deigned to notice me, or my invitation, beckoning a page to be my guide. "Show Miss Jennings to Her Grace, Wilkins," he said, already turning to the gentleman behind me. "Be quick about it, too." "So you are to be the new maid of honour, Miss Jennings," the page said as he led me down the hall. He was not much older than I, his skin so ablaze with pimples that it matched the scarlet coat of his livery. "You look fresh and sweet as new cream." "I'm nearly 13, I said as grandly as I could. Like every girl my age, I was eager to put aside my childhood for what I was certain would be better. "That's quite old enough to be a maid of honour."
"Old enough for mischief, that's for certain."
He looked me up and down with approval.
"His Grace will make short work of a little morsel like you."
"That's impudent talk,"
I said, shocked he'd dare say such a thing.
"Where's your respect for your master?"
"It's there before His Grace's face whenever I need it," the boy said, unperturbed. "He doesn't pay much heed to us lads anyway. It's the women he likes. If you're wise, you'll keep yourself to company and away from his path, unless that's why you're here. There's plenty that are. Mark you, here comes the Countess of Fitzwilliam. You know how to make your curtsy, don't you?"
"Of course I do,"
I whispered sharply as I stepped to one side and lowered my eyes. I put my heels together, bent my knees and dipped deeply as the Countess and her 2 attendants passed us by. "You must learn every lady and lord at court by sight and by rank," the boy said.
"And who deserves which salute? You'll lose your place if you don't. Mind the dog there."
"Must I curtsy for her too, if she's a peer's dog?"
I pulled my petticoat to one side of the large yellow bitch sprawled across the floor before me, languidly flopping her tail with a steady thump.
"Oh, it's worse at Whitehall," the boy continued, as we turned to climb a staircase.
"Both His Grace and His Majesty are mad for beasts, but His Majesty fair worships his dogs. They say there's more dogs than whores in that palace, and all of them lolling about wherever they please." I didn't answer, unsure exactly how to reply to this flippant link between dogs and royal mistresses. Besides, there were dogs everywhere here, and it seemed that I'd only traded the stench of the stable for that of the kennel. There was another familiar smell, too, one of too many chamber pots and too many people living too closely together, regardless of their rank, though here at least it was mingled with the sweeter wafting stink of perfume.
"Have we much farther to go?"
I asked, as we turned down another long, dark hall. Perhaps things would improve when we drew closer to the royal quarters. "Around this corner," he said, and my hopes sank. I dreamed so long of visiting the more noble part of the palace that the reality was sadly disappointing. The halls were more spacious here, true. The benches beneath the leaden windows were covered in dark red plush, and the ceiling overhead was a fairy tracery of cast plaster. Yet these same ceilings were smudged with soot from candles and fires, and even the dark panelling along the walls, carved to mimic folded drapery, was filmed with the fine grey dust that drifted from the breweries near Charing Cross. But then my eyes widened
as I saw something far, far different hanging there on the wall before us, and I forgot the dust. An enormous painting, with figures sized near to life, and beyond a wisp of drapery, every last one was without clothing.
"Ah, that won't be the last of those, you see," the boy said, laughing at my embarrassment. "His and Her Grace do like their paintings and sculptures made from marble, too. Her Grace brought crates and crates of them with her from Italy, along with her own cooks and confessors. That one's supposed to be an allegory of pagan love." I frowned with disapproval at the lascivious, unclothed people. I'd no notion of what an allegory might be, but I wanted no part of one, nor of pagan love either.
"I thought Her Grace was supposed to be a pious lady."
"She's a papist," he said, as if that explained everything. "They say she wished to bury herself away in a nunnery, too, but the Pope himself made her marry His Grace and come to London. They say he's ordered her to save our English souls from hell and betray us all to King Louis and the French. I should like to see her try."
I remembered the bonfires and burning straw effigies in protest of the Duke's marriage to the Italian, Mary Beatrice of Modena, and the ugly prints that were posted about the city, portraying the new Duchess hand in hand with a crook-backed Pope and a leering French King Louis leading England to unholy ruin. "My soul does perfectly well in the keeping of the Church of England, thank you." But the boy shook his head.
"Take care, Miss Jennings. Most folk in England may be like us, but His Grace already leans towards his wife's Romish faith, and they say he'd even have his daughters, the princesses, raised in it, if His Majesty would let him. Best to keep your own beliefs close, if you wish to prosper in this household. Here we are."
We'd stopped before tall double doors, flanked by a pair of guardsmen in the uniform of the Duke's own company. They took no notice of Wilkins or me, or perhaps because they recognized him, they judged us not worth bothering over. The boy rapped on the door, and my heart thumped in my chest. I smoothed my skirts one last time and bit my lips to make them redder.
"Remember me, Duck,"
Wilkins whispered behind me, and just before the door swung open, he reached down and pinched my bottom through my skirts.
"Your Grace, Miss Jennings,"
the footman announced, and I only just managed to close my gaping, gasping mouth and curtsy.
"Come, come, Miss Jennings, let me look at you."
The young woman in the tall back chair smiled at me, her needlework in her hands, and a half-dozen richly dressed attendants sitting about her, on low cushioned stalls called tabourets, at court. I'd known the Duchess was young, only 16, but somehow I'd expected the weight of her title and responsibilities to have given her gravity beyond her years. Instead, I found Mary Beatrice to be warm, her smile eager, and despite the dark colouring to her hair and skin that were the legacy of her deceased ancestors, she had a natural elegance and grace. I guessed she'd also be an easy, obliging mistress to serve, and my desire to be chosen rose even higher. I stepped forward and swept my woolen skirts gracefully as I curtsied, presenting myself for her approval.
"You were recommended as a true English beauty, Miss Jennings."
She chose her words with great care, bending her tongue around a language that must still be so foreign to her.
"That judgment is most correct."
"Thank you, Your Grace,"
I murmured, taking care to venture no more. The main role of a maid of honour was to be an agreeable ornament to the court, and I was determined to prove I could be precisely that. She leaned a little closer, studying me.
"How many years do you have, Miss Jennings?"
"I am 13, Your Grace."
"So young,"
she exclaimed, and a shadow of sadness crossed her face. Was she thinking of her own tender age, or was she regretting how, like every princess, she'd been married off for political gain, and her own sweet youth squandered on a husband 25 years her senior?
"You shall make a fair companion to Lady Mary, and Lady Anne too."
I nodded again, barely able to hide my excitement. These two princesses were her stepdaughters, His Grace's children by the first Duchess. To be companion to them would be as great an honour as with Her Grace herself.
The Duchess looked down for a moment, wrapping a strand of silk floss around and around her fingertip.
You have no lover, Miss Jennings, do you?
Oh, no, Your Grace.
I flushed, my cheeks hot at such a question, and the other ladies laughed slyly behind their hands or fans at my discomfiture.
Not at all.
The Duchess raised her hand, and at once the laughter stopped.
I am glad, she said. I do not like bold intrigues in my household, Miss Jennings.
Someone sniggered, barely turning the sound into a cough. Later, when I knew more, I understood the jest, for there was never a household more given to intrigues of every sort than this one, with the master himself leading the whole sordid parade. But at the time, all I did was nod.
No, Your Grace. That is, I shall not be bold.
I wouldn't think you would.
She smiled again, her teeth as fine and regular as the pearls around her throat.
We find you most acceptable, Miss Jennings. When will you join us?
Oh, at once, Your Grace, at once,
I cried, swept away by my enthusiasm.
A thousand gratitudes, Your Grace, and I promise I'll never give you cause for regret.
Never, Miss Jennings?
She said archly, laughing, and the others followed and laughed as well.
How pleasing that would be, if true.
Behind me, I heard a door open and the rustling of skirts, and Mary Beatrice's attention shifted away from me to the newcomer. Of course, I could not turn to look. To show my back to Her Grace or any other of a higher rank was strictly forbidden at court.
You are done with your music, Master, Lady Anne?
The Duchess asked with the same eagerness to please, holding out her hand to the girl who'd entered with her governess.
Was he content with your new piece?
Coming before me, Lady Anne only shrugged and brushed her pursed lips across the Duchess's presented cheek with as little affection as possible. She was just 8, tall and plump for her age, with dun-coloured hair and a plain face above a gold-coloured silk gown that echoed those of the other ladies in miniature. Her eyes were famously weak. Everyone in London had heard of the foreign surgeons and failed cures, and her constant weeping squint gave her a look of cross displeasure.
Did you play well, Anne?
The Duchess persisted, and again the only answer she received from the girl was another silent lift of her shoulders. Of course, this did not make Mary Beatrice happy, her arched black brows drawing together as she watched the girl walk away from her. I watched them thoughtfully. It was clear there was no excess of love between them, something I would do well to remember.
We have a new maid of honor, Anne,
the Duchess said, with a cheer that seemed forced.
This is Miss Sarah Jennings.
She pointed to me, and as the princess turned, I curtsied yet again. Lady Anne considered me with wary interest, the way she might a new puppy that could perhaps bite.
I get sweetmeats with my tea when I play my harpsichord piece without mistakes, she said. They're bringing me a dish of them now. Do you like sweetmeats, Miss Jennings?
Yes, Lady Anne,
I said carefully, suspecting this royal puppy might bite too.
I do. Then you shall eat them with me.
Without waiting for my reply, she headed for the small mahogany tea table that had been set for her near the window. I glanced back to the Duchess, who motioned for me to follow, and as I joined Lady Anne, a footman magically appeared with a second chair for me.
Sit, Miss Jennings,
Lady Anne ordered, swinging her legs gently as she surveyed the silver dish of little cakes placed before her.
You have my leave. I like these ones with the jam centres the best.
Thank you, my lady.
I sat gingerly on the edge of the chair. Choosing sweetmeats with a princess was far beyond my experience, and I feared desperately that somehow I'd err and lose my new position before I fair had it.
Eat.
Lady Anne popped one of the sweetmeats into her mouth, licking her fingers.
I wouldn't have asked you otherwise.
I plucked the nearest sweet from the plate and took the daintiest of bites, not wishing to be caught with my mouth over full. Lady Anne took another, squinting at me closely.
You haven't told me how fortunate I am.
Fortunate, my lady?
I asked, mystified. though the other women had begun to speak amongst themselves again. I suspected they were listening too. "To have Mary Beatrice as my new mother," she said, "because she is young and beautiful and clever. Everyone tells me I am fortunate that she married my father, but you did not."
"Careful, Sarah. Careful."
"It said that a mother is impossible to replace, my lady." She turned her hand to lick a stray dribble of red jam that had fallen onto the emerald ring she wore on her little finger. "My mother is dead, and my aunt, and my grandmother, and all four of my little brothers. We live in perilous times, my lady." This was sadly true. In the last half century, poor England had suffered through a civil war, a great fire that had destroyed much of London, and a hideous plague that had claimed thousands of lives across the country. "My father died 5 years ago." Strangely, that caught her interest.
"How, Miss Jennings? How did he die?"
"He had long suffered a weakness of the heart, my lady," I said. "The final attack seized him with great pain, but his last suffering was quick."
"May God have mercy on his soul."
She nodded, satisfied.
"My mother died of a wasting cancer that ate away at her breasts and bowels from within. Her agony was so great that my father brought her priest to comfort her and gave her last rites in the Romish church. My mother never would have tolerated that if she hadn't been so ill. My father thought no one would find out, but we did."
She smoothed the cuff of her embroidered linen cap between her fingers, heedless of the jam she smeared upon it. Lady Anne was testing me, and I knew it as well as she did herself. Did I side with her, who had been raised like me in the Church of England, or with her stepmother, my new mistress, who followed Rome and the Pope? I thought of what the boy Wilkins had told me of keeping myself free of the question of faith in this household. Yet here that same question had already dug its claws into me.
"If Her Grace, your mother, was out of her wits from pain, my lady, then what she said or did would not count, would it?"
I reasoned, not really sure myself. Lady Anne nodded solemnly.
"Dr. Compton says it doesn't, and he's the Bishop of London."
"Then it must be so, my lady," I said, trying not to think of how odd this conversation was.
"Her Grace's soul must be safe."
"I believe it is too."
Lady Anne sighed and bit into another sweet, the red jam oozing from the corner of her mouth.
"I believe she's safe with the angels in our heaven."
She leaned over the table towards me, lowering her voice.
"You told me the truth, Miss Jennings," she said.
"No one else does that. You didn't tell me what you thought I should hear, what I wanted to, like everyone else."
Was this a compliment or not?
"Yes, my lady," I said at last. "I was truthful, my lady."
She smiled, her teeth speckled with sticky raspberry seeds.
"I like that, Miss Jennings. I like you. You must be here each day for me."
"Yes, Lady Anne,"
I said, keeping my amazement to myself, because I didn't yet possess a courteous sense of what to say to best please those I served. Because I was still so guileless and had spoken only the truth, I'd managed to please the princess and win her favor. I smiled back and slipped the rest of my sweetmeat into my mouth. If making my way at court was to be this easy, I thought with the foolishness of my youth, why then? How could I do otherwise than prosper?
"You must watch yourself in that place, Sarah," my mother said, watching my preparations with her hands clasped at her waist. She hadn't offered to help me pack my belongings, nor did I wish her to. "There'll be plenty of villains waiting to prey upon you."
"I'm only a maid of honor, mother."
I began laying my clothes into my trunk. A small neat stack of plain petticoats and smocks, rolled knots of stockings, silken garters coiled like brightly coloured serpents. It wasn't much for a lady going to court, where new fashions were slavishly followed, but the Duchess would help dress me in a fitting way once I was in her household.
a porter to carry my chest and a footman to escort me, waiting outside to take me to my new quarters in the palace. And in a way, I felt as if I were already there.
I'll scarce be noticed at all,
Mother sniffed, her expression sour beneath her starched widow's hood. I'd thought she'd rejoice for my good fortune, but ever since I'd returned this last time to gather my things, she'd been shrill and full of dire complaint, and I was wary of the temper that too often rose from her displeasure. With your fair hair, they'll notice you quick enough, she warned. You'll be no more than another pretty tidbit to that pack of wolves.
I'm not so foolish as that, Mother, I protested. I know my worth, and I mean to make the most of it.
Now that I'd like to see, Sarah, she said. You playing at being as grand as that Romish foreign duchess.
You won't be able to see me at all, Mother, not once I'm part of the Duke of York's household, I said warmly, without thinking of the consequences. You won't be allowed past the guards without an express invitation.
That's bold talk to your own mother, isn't it?
She said, her voice now brittle with anger and her face turning livid. Others whispered that my mother had a witch's powers, and when her temper took her like this, I could almost believe it myself.
You'll see. You'll be no better than all the other hussies when the first gallant whispers his pretty words into your ear.
I will be different.
I began tossing the last of my things into the trunk willy-nilly, desperate to be gone.
And I'm not another hussy.
You are, if I say so, daughter.
She grabbed me by the wrist, pulling me around to face her.
You think you know so much more than I. What do you know of court? What do you know of the world?
I thought of how well I'd done earlier with the Duchess, and with Lady Anne, and with brave, if unwise, defiance, I raised my chin.
I already know more than you do. The Duchess of York herself has invited me to join her household, while you...
Her hand caught me hard across the cheek, striking the very words from my mouth, and though I'd felt such blows many times before, the sting was always doubly sharp because it came from my mother. I pulled free and stumbled away, putting the bed between us.
Ungrateful little baggage,
she shouted, her eyes full of the familiar old fury.
Go to your fine new friends and see how long they want you. Just don't come back here whimpering to me when some noble rascal's filled your belly with his bastard and cast you off without a penny.
I slammed the lid of my trunk shut and fled into the hall. I told the porter to fetch the trunk, ignoring how he stared at the red mark of my mother's hand that I knew must be blazed on my cheek.
You're a proud, ungrateful wench, Sarah,
my mother shouted after me from the door.
You always have been, and you'll never be anything else.
With my head high, as if nothing were amiss, I nodded to the page and the porter with my trunk on his back, and together we started towards the far side of the palace and the royal apartments. And I never once looked back. I stretched as tall as I could to look over the wall, the hem of my satin petticoat snagging on the rough bricks. The privy garden behind the palace was empty except for the moonlight. A pale wash over the marble bench and bare branches of the espaliered pear trees pegged flat to the walls.
Where is this great show you promised, Lady Anne?
I whispered, my words coming in little puffs of warmth in the cold night air. I rubbed my hands together, wishing I'd brought gloves.
I see nothing extraordinary. She will come, I vow,
Anne insisted, though the anxiety in her whisper showed no such confidence.
You'll see with your own eyes, Miss Jennings. Like the great whore of Babylon herself she is.
I could hear the princess's excitement in the tremble of her voice, whispering the forbidden word aloud there in the dark. Of course, King Charles's court at that time was so wicked that even a swaddling babe would soon know of whores and bawds and jades of every rank. But because of who we two girls were, in the company of others, we were expected to feign the blindest innocence, as was proper for ladies of our tenderling age and station.
There she is, Miss Jennings,
Anne said, her whisper squeaking upwards.
There, exactly as I promised.
Hush now, or she'll mark us. I jerked Anne down lower beside me, so only her eyes peeked over the mossy-topped wall. The lady, for a lady whore she must be, to have found her way into this garden, moved with swift purpose to the bench, the gathered tail of her skirts catching on the rough crushed shells of the path. The silver-shot silk of her gown glistened in the moonlight, and her deep Flemish cuffs swung back and forth as she fluttered her fan before her face, more from nervousness than from need on this chilly night. Even through the screen of leaves and branches, I recognized her, and I wondered that Anne didn't too, or why she would pretend otherwise. The lady's name was Arabella Churchill, and she was, like me, a part of our own household here at court, another maid of honor to the Duchess. But that wasn't the reason I'd no wish to linger here to spy. I took Anne's arm, meaning to lead her away. "We've tarried here long enough. Come, my lady. We'll be missed if we don't return to the others."
"No, we won't."
Anne pulled her arm free, willful and stubborn.
"Not yet. Look, there is the whore's lover now."
Against all my better judgment, I obeyed, looking to where she pointed. The man was more difficult to see through the branches, his wig long and full and flopping over his shoulders, hiding his face from us in the shadows. His coat and waistcoat glittered with gold, the flaring star of his rank embroidered over his heart. I'd been wise to worry.
"Come, my lady, this is not proper, nor right."
But again, Anne shook me away, instead intent on the couple before us.
"She cares not who watches, nor does he," she said,
paying me no heed.
"I know. I've been here before. She was one of my mother's maids. The whore."
Even through the veil of the trees, we saw it all. There was no courtship, no wooing. The gentleman hooked his thumbs into the wide neckline of the lady's gown, sliding the stiffened collar over her shoulders and down her arms until her breasts popped free. He filled his hands with the yielding flesh, bending to bite at her throat. And though her black-gloved hands clung to his back, she turned her head away, towards us. By the moonlight, I could see the resignation in the lady's face, the same that I'd seen once on a stag at the end of its run, waiting with the huntsman's knife at its panting throat. Anne's fat little fingers moved restlessly around mine, her palms turning moist. I told myself I should not look to see more, yet still I was Anne's sorry match in guilty fascination, pulling her closer to me against the brick wall. She was trembling, my poor lady, and I would comfort her however I could. With rough force, the gentleman turned the lady and shoved her face first over the arm of the bench. He threw the drapery of her petticoats over her hips and unfastened the fall of his breeches, and with a low, wordless grunt, plunged his member deep within her, jerking against her like an alley mongrel with his bitch. I turned away, unable to watch any longer, and pressed myself against the wall to steady my shaking knees.
"I would never let a man use me like that,"
I said, fair spitting the words. My heart raced, and my face felt hot with shame for Anne, and for me, and for Arabella Churchill, too.
"I'll never grant a man that power over me. Never, my lady. Never."
Anne twisted closer to me, her rounded body feverishly warm where our skin touched in the cold night air.
"You would if they forced you to," she said. "Women must do as men say."
For Anne, that was sadly true. A princess is no more than a pawn in worldly games, a pawn who must take whatever convenient prince is pushed into her bed. But not I. I was only Miss Jennings, poor and fatherless and common born, with no dowry beyond my face and my cleverness and my desire to play my part grandly on the stage of life.
"I'll not bend to any man's whim, my lady,"
I vowed fiercely.
"Never. You will swear to it."
Her pleading eyes were too bright, too desperate in her childish face.
"Everyone says that whore in the garden barters her body to better her situation at court. But you would not do that, Sarah Jennings, would you?"
I know now that I had come to King Charles's court too young, and lapped up the heady poison of corruption and deceit with my innocent tongue. Now I know that I learned too soon to judge and value others first by what they could do for me, and I learned as well to find no wrong in the practice. When I looked at Anne's round face, I saw not only my youthful companion and the princess I was bound to serve, but also a protector for my future, a link in the golden chain that ran directly to the throne itself. I will not leave you, Lady Anne, I promised, my words soft as velvet. It was easy to make such reckless promises at 13, and easy to keep them too. I swear to you, I never will. She twisted her fingers deeper into mine and pressed her lips, sticky from spun sugar sweets, to the back of my hand.
I trust you, Sarah,
she whispered, her voice ripe with fervency.
You are my friend, and I'll trust you like no other.
I kissed her dimpled hand in return, and felt the warmth of her loyalty and her love. I didn't dream that. Like every good courtier, she might have played me as I sought to play her. On the other side of the wall we heard voices and laughter, and with guilty haste we brushed the twigs and flecks of dirt from our petticoats.
Come, Miss Jennings, hurry!
Anne whispered as we cut our path beneath the hanging boughs, back to the gallery.
As soon as the whore is done pleasuring father, he will leave her and return to the company.
Oh, yes. I had come to court too young. Chapter 2. St. James's Palace, London. January, 1674.
James was away from his lady for nearly a month, Lady Ainsworth said as she shuffled the playing cards. And Mary Beatrice was most eager to see him when he returned here last night. Most eager. I'd wager a guinea that she'll keep him abed for the rest of this day, likely tonight as well.
Across the table from her, Lady Symington smiled and idly twisted one of her long chestnut curls around her fingers. I was sitting with the two older ladies in waiting in the Duchess's gallery, the afternoon sunlight streaming in through the long row of arched windows while they played ombre. After 6 weeks in Her Grace's service, I'd learned what was expected of me. We ladies were ready if Mary Beatrice had need of us, but until she did, our time was our own to squander or make use of as we chose. Most played cards with relentless passion. Loo, all fours, ombre, piquet, rough, and honours. But I kept away from the table, unable to play for the enormous stakes that the other ladies wagered, as much as 1,000 guineas in a single night. Instead, I sat to one side on one of the tabourets, with a book of sonnets open in my lap, pretending to read while I listened shamelessly to the conversation around me. Lady Symington took her cards and found them in her hand, her pearl bracelet slipping down her wrist. As idle as we were, she was still dressed in the most costly French fashion, the folds of her silk lute-string skirts falling gracefully around the nipped toes of her damask-covered mules.
His Grace had no right being apart from his wife for so long, she said. No matter what business may have kept him abroad, not unless, of course, he'd left her with a babe on the way.
Oh, I'll venture James has done his duty by her, Lady Ainsworth arched a single brow. Her husband had been a supporter and boon companion of the king from the time of his exile in France, and Lady Ainsworth had benefited from his loyalty too. He is a steward, after all, and he sired enough brats to know how it's done. But did he go to Arabella's house first, I wonder, or Mary Beatrice's? My cheeks flamed, remembering the shameful scene that Lady Anne and I had witnessed between Miss Churchill and the Duke. But Lady Symington misread my shame.
Hush,
she said, and glanced pointedly at me. I knew her caution wasn't so much for my youth and innocence, but because they still didn't know whether I was to be trusted.
Mind your words, sweet.
But the other lady ignored the warning. Who can fault him for turning to his mistress? Neither of his wives has graced him with a son who's lived longer than a few breaths. I say it's God's own curse. The same as with the poor king and queen. Not even the Stuart seed can find purchase in a barren Catholic womb. Lady Symington sighed and laid her first card on the table.
The Duchess isn't like the queen,
She's not barren. She's already been with child once. And lost it.
But she's taking all the right precautions for the proper outcome next time, reasoned Lady Symington. You see her each morning, too, holding her nose as she chokes down those vile concoctions the midwives have made for her. She wants a child as much as the rest of us.
What we want is not only a boy, but an Anglican heir to the throne. Lady Ainsworth nodded, her dimpled chin bobbing up and down. That's what England needs, and what she was brought here to do. You know the king would embrace his brother's son as if he were his own.
This was hardly news to anyone at court, or in London for that matter. While Anne and Mary, the two princesses, had been safely raised as Anglicans, a male heir to the throne was most sorely needed. But how could any Englishman or woman with a clear eye for our country's future wish differently? As young as I was, I still feared what would become of tiny Protestant England if pitted against the great Catholic powers of France, Spain, Portugal, and Rome. I feared their intolerance and their hateful persecution of others unlike themselves. And most of all, I feared what would happen to the rest of us Anglicans if a Catholic king were ever again to sit on the throne of England. But at least now, I knew that these two ladies were Protestants as well. While it was easy to tell that the Duchess's Italian attendants, among her ladies-in-waiting, was her childhood friend, the Countess Lucrezia Pretonari Vezzani, while her confessor was Father Antonio Giudici, was sympathetic to her faith. Guessing among the English ones could be more hazardous.
Grant the Duchess a bit of time, Lady Symington was saying. She'll bear James his son when she's ready. You forget how young she is, and that her body still needs time to ripen for childbearing.
But Lady Ainsworth only sniffed to show her disregard for the Duchess's lack of a son.
16's not so very young, she said.
There's plenty of wives younger than that with a ring of children around their knees. How old are you, Miss Jennings? Startled, I just remembered to look up as if I'd been pulled from my book.
Yes, my lady?
She smiled indulgently, running her fingers back and forth across her bracelets.
How old are you, Poppet?
13, my lady, I said.
14 in June.
Truly?
She asked, the surprise now hers.
I thought you were older than that.
Certainly the gentleman will, you know. Most people did believe me older, especially since Her Grace had replaced my plain wool clothes with the more elegant finery that was more suitable to my new place in her household. She particularly liked me in the gown I wore today, broad red and green stripes, cleverly mitered and pleated, to show off the narrowness of my waist, with the fine border of Venetian lace on my linen smock, peeking above the gown's low neckline. I'd learned to lace my stays more tightly too, like the other ladies, and was proud of how round and womanly the whalebone made my budding breasts appear.
13, you say?
Lady Symington studied me over her cards, her blue eyes full of doubt. Neither of these ladies could be more than 5 or 6 years my senior, though I'd grant they were vastly older in worldly experience. Has the Duke met you yet? I shook my head, and the smile they exchanged between them said much that excluded me.
Miss Jennings, Miss Jennings, Lady Ainsworth said, her voice like a tigress's purr. His Grace's welcome to you will be very warm, very warm.
Oh, stop!
Lady Symington laughed, holding her cards up to her face.
Don't frighten the poor lass. I don't mean to frighten, only inform.
Lady Symington made a face, then turned towards me.
Tell us, Miss Jennings, did your mother speak to you of how women conceive babes? Do you know how such things occur?
Yes, my lady, I answered promptly.
Mother had been so afraid that I'd be led astray by some low apprentice or stable boy that she'd begun lecturing me on this same subject long before I needed it.
I know what men do with their wives.
With their wives? Lady Ainsworth said, teasing.
And with their mistresses, and their scullery maids, and any other female with half a breath left in her body.
Again they laughed together, their heads tossed back
and their jeweled earbobs dancing against their cheeks, making me flush with shame for my ignorance. Was I that great an innocent fool for them to find such amusement at my expense? Lady Simonton reached out and patted my shoulder.
What she's saying, my dear, is that at court the gentlemen often have many more opportunities to indulge themselves than other men might.
Lady Ainsworth chuckled, her eyes heavy-lidded and sly. So do the ladies, if they wish it.
If they wish it, said Lady Simonton sternly. You'll be much pursued, Miss Jennings, not only because you are so fair, but because you are so young. You'll find a great many gentlemen who believe that plucking a virgin's maidenhead is the best sport in the world.
The heat in my cheeks grew warmer still, and I marveled that they could speak with this freedom and ease about such things.
I don't wish to be any gentleman's sport, my lady.
Nor should you, she said firmly. No matter how much a gentleman presses Miss Jennings, you don't have to grant him so much as a kiss, unless you're willing to. You're not some milkmaid ripe for tumbling behind a hedgerow. You're a lady, a maid of honour to her grace. Even if it's the Duke himself, ha! Even if it's His Majesty, you can refuse him.
Especially if it's the Duke, the randy old goat.
Lady Ainsworth wrinkled her nose with disdain.
But 'tis not all so bad, little Miss Jennings. If you find a gentleman who does please you, no one here or at Whitehall will look askance if you decide to take him as your lover.
Thank you, my lady, I said. But I don't believe I will.
That made her smile, though I'd never intended it should.
You're only 13.
Wait until you've danced in the great hall at the palace and had all the handsome young bucks come panting and pouring after you.
But you must take care, Miss Jennings, warned Lady Simonton. Maids of honour must appear to be maids, even if few enough of them are.
If you get caught with some gentleman's child swelling up beneath your smock, why then, Her Grace will have no choice but to send you home.
Or into keeping, Lady Ainsworth said blithely.
If that's the game you choose, it depends upon your circumstances. You are quite poor, aren't you? No portion to speak of.
My father lost nearly everything because he supported His Majesty's cause, my lady. I have no gold, nor land, nor title to bring to a husband.
I knew they pitied me, because I was poor by their standards, if not those of the rest of the world. I didn't care. I was still proud of who I was, and I raised my chin as high as I dared.
My fortune lies in my person and my wit.
So it does, Miss Jennings, Lady Ainsworth said, appraising me. So it does, and a splendid fortune for a woman it is. She turned up one of the cards before her, a red queen, and with a half-smile held it between two fingers for me to see. You're clever enough to make some besotted wretch pay quite dearly for your favours. This court, even this household, has seen its share of women who've bettered themselves that way, and not all of them have been actresses either. Lady Castlemaine is a Villiers by birth, yet with every bastard she bears the king, she increases her power and her wealth.
But that's not what I want, my lady, I protested unhappily.
Not at all. Of course you don't, pet. Not yet, Lady Simonton said easily. And who can fault you for it? I shook my head in silence, unable to explain. Yes, I wanted wealth and power and the otherworldly benefits that could come to those at court. But I didn't want them at the price of my soul. Nor was my heart so avaricious that I would put aside all thoughts of love and common happiness and spread my legs for a powerful man for the sake of gold or a title, the way that Arabella Churchill had. What I longed for more was a partner, a friend, a gentleman to share my life and my love, as well as my ambitions. And if such a paragon did not exist, why, then I'd be like the great Virgin Queen herself, and never wed. But these noble ladies didn't begin to understand my silence, nor truly did they wish to. I offered much more amusement otherwise. You know, Miss Jennings, There are ways to stay the whole wretched process, Lady Ainsworth said, with that same knowing half-wink that I was beginning to dread. Not that your mamma would have told you. No, no. But I know where one can purchase small linen casings made to cover your lover's staff and keep his essence from mingling with yours to make an inconvenient babe. Or you might prefer to follow the French manner and receive the gentleman into your mouth instead of...
Please, please spare the poor innocent,
Lady Symington exclaimed, her gaze rolling up towards the heavens in feigned distress worthy of the stage. Next you'll fetch the Aretino from beneath your pillow, by way of illustration. They laughed uproariously at that, while I prayed the queasiness I felt did not show upon my face. Though a virgin still, I'd thought I'd known all there was about the act between wedded women and men. But now it seemed I was as ill-schooled in this as I was in Latin and Greek. I frowned, determined not to be ignorant any longer.
Please, my lady, might I ask, what is this Aretino, and what does it illustrate?
They laughed again, with Lady Symington forced to clap her hands over her mouth to stop.
It's a wicked, wicked book, Lady Ainsworth explained. Brought to me from Venice by a certain wicked gentleman.
It explains all the postures and positions most advantageous to lovemaking, and the illustrations show them. From the way her eyes sparked and her tongue rolled around the word wicked, I realized with shock that the wicked gentleman was most likely her lover, not her lordly husband. Her lover. I knew that nearly all the great gentlemen here at court kept mistresses in addition to their wives, but I'd yet to meet a lady who'd done the same to her husband.
Oh,
I said faintly, now hoping very much that she didn't produce the book for me to see.
Thank you, my lady.
But Lady Symington was laughing still, pressing her fingers to her lips, as if she could feel her own mirth bubbling out.
More correctly, it's a book about swiving, Miss Jennings, she said, pausing just long enough to nip the tip of her finger between her small white teeth.
There's precious little to do with love anywhere in those pages. I looked down at the book of sonnets by an Italian poet that the Duchess had given to me, sonnets that were full of love and honour and noble deeds. There was nothing in them about linen casings or curious postures, and nothing either in my own dreams of a gentleman who'd make me his wife. Hearing these high-born ladies speak so wantonly reminded me of the dog-leavings scattered throughout the palace halls, sordid reminders that there was an ugly side to the lives of even the most noble folk.
Cazzo dritto, non volt concilio,
the foreign words spilled salaciously from Lady Symington's lips, words she then translated for my reluctant benefit.
One cannot quarrel with a standing cock.
Surely you must have heard that little proverb by now, my dear.
I could send for Maestro Aretino's book for you, Miss Jennings, Lady Ainsworth said, as if she was daring me, and perhaps she was. It would take but a minute to fetch. Then you could judge the quality of the dialogues and the pictures for yourself.
What book?
Lady Anne asked, joining us unannounced, with her governess and a page trailing after her.
I should like to see a book with pictures, Lady Ainsworth, for I cannot abide reading. The words make my eyes hurt.
Hurriedly we three rose to our feet, our heads bowed as we curtsied in near unison to the princess.
Good day, Lady Anne,
Lady Ainsworth said, her manner now sweet enough to lure a honeybee.
Permit me to venture that the book in question would be of scant interest to you. It's a dry book for scholars, my lady, full of foreign words and expressions.
Anne scowled, suspicious.
If the book is so boring and tedious, then why were you offering to show it to Miss Jennings? Why won't you show it to me?
Lady Ainsworth perceived a lack in my education, my lady, that needed correction, I said quickly, praying that Lady Ainsworth would follow my lead, despite the difference in our ranks. Not only would it be unthinkable for her to show her wicked book to the princess, but the pious young Duchess would be furious if she learned one of her ladies kept such a volume for her amusement. And as for me, if at my age I were linked with this Aretino, then I was quite certain my first month at court would become my last. I smiled at the princess. Lady Ainsworth only wished to improve my knowledge by showing me a book brought from Venice. She meant nothing more. Oh, so it's Italian. Anne wrinkled her nose with disdain for her stepmother's country, her interest in the book instantly gone. I'd rather play cards anyway. She came to the table, her high red lacquered heels, a subtle sign of her nobility, clattering over the bare floor. Without a thought, she took Lady Symington's chair and began to push the cards left from their game into a stack. I looked over her head to Lady Ainsworth, expecting that she would give me some silent sign to show her gratitude for what I'd just done. But instead, her expression was cold and haughty, and in place of the ally I thought I'd made, it seemed I'd somehow gained a fresh enemy instead. "Miss Jennings, sit," ordered Lady Anne. "I will play with only you, for I feel sure you won't try to cheat me, like everyone else does." "Yes, Lady Anne." I moved to the chair on the other side of the table and waited for the princess to finish shuffling the cards. "Mary Beatrice's maid dressed my hair differently this morning," Anne said suddenly, pausing with the cards in her chubby, childish hands. "Do you like it?" "It's most becoming to you, Lady Anne," Lady Symington said eagerly, nodding for extra emphasis. "And quite the latest fashion, too." Anne ducked her chin low, her mouth set into a tight, stubborn line. "Regard me, Miss Jennings, and tell me the truth. Does the dress of my hair become me?" I looked at the princess's fine, light brown hair, now scraped back from her wide forehead and twisted into tortuous curls, stiffened into place with sugar water. The princess already knew the truth, and so did I. "No, my lady, it does not," I said softly, wishing to gentle my verdict. "But then, not every fashion suits every face." Her response came so slowly that I feared I'd misstepped. But when her smile finally broke across her plain little face, it was as bright and full of wonder as the sun rising over a mountaintop. "You are right, Miss Jennings," she said, her words coming in a shy rush that was almost a whisper. "My hair is ugly. Oh, Miss Jennings, why is it that you are the only one I can trust to tell me the truth? The only one who will treat me as a friend would?" I nodded and smiled in return. The only answer that would do. Perhaps I should have rejoiced at having won the princess's trust again, and again, simply by telling her the truth as I'd seen it. But already I'd learned that at court, truth meant nothing, and trust even less. And though I was glad that the princess believed she could trust me, I wondered how much, or how little, I, in turn, could ever trust her, or anyone else. 2 days later, I finally met my new master, the Duke of York. I had gone walking with Mary Beatrice and several of her other ladies in the park. Snow had fallen in the night, just enough to cover the pointed blades of grass and dust over the statues and benches. The Italian-born Duchess was fascinated by our English snow and insisted on going outside soon after dawn. With most snowstorms, the palace gardener's boys would be sent out with brooms and shovels to clear the paths for the ladies. But on this day, the Duchess had ordered that the paths remain untouched. She bundled herself in furs and veils against the cold and urged her sleepy ladies to hurry from their beds to join her. With her small pack of flop-eared spaniels leaping around her skirts, Mary Beatrice set out into the snow. She took one deliberate step, then another, lifting her skirt so she could see the footprints, her high-heeled shoes left in the unblemished snow. I was the only one of her ladies who'd followed closely, the rest slow and grumpy at being roused so early on such an errand. And Mary Beatrice turned to look over her shoulder at me, her cheeks pink from the cold. "The snow is most delightful, Miss Jennings, is it not?" she asked merrily, her accented words turning to little clouds in the chilly air. "Come, follow me," she laughed and plunged ahead into the snow, heedless of how her silk-covered shoes were being ruined. But I laughed too and ran with her like the young creatures we were. And for those few moments, I almost forgot that she was my mistress and the Duchess of York and a foreign-born papist. The little dogs raced in mindless circles around us, just as glad to be free of the stuffy palace, and yipped and yapped at each other
as they tossed bits of snow into the air. "Here, Jip, here!" the Duchess called to one of her favourites. But when she bent to brush the snow from its muzzle, the little dog leaped up and caught her glove in its teeth, pulling it free of her fingers. With a small, fierce growl, the dog worried the glove, then bolted off across the snowy grass with its prize. At once I drew off my own glove and offered it to her. "Take mine, Your Grace," I said with a quick curtsy. "You must keep your fingers warm." But she waved away my offer, her bare hand cocked over her eyes against the sun as she looked for the rascally dog. "Tell that to Jip, Miss Jennings," she said, laughing again. "Spoiled little beast. I won't chill your hand too because he's being so ill-behaved. Run back to my dressing room, Miss Jennings, and ask Pellegrina to give you another pair." "Yes, Your Grace," I said, backing away from her through the snow. I ran up the stairs to the Duchess's apartments, eager to be done with this errand, so I could return outside. With the fresh gloves in my hand, I hurried back to the withdrawing room, and there, so directly in my path that we nearly collided, stood my master, James, the Duke of York.
"Your Grace,"
I gasped, dipping low.
"Forgive me, I did not see you."
"No harm done, sweetheart," he said and smiled. "None at all." James was nearly as tall as his brother, the King, though there was scarce other resemblance between them, or between him and his daughter, Lady Anne, either. At past 40, the Duke was still a handsome man, his jaw firm, and his blue eyes clear, and he'd yet to put on the extra flesh that most men his age acquired. He must have come from his bedchamber, for he wore a voluminous Indian gown of gold and plum silk damask, his shirt beneath it open at the throat, and his feet in black silk mules. He had not yet put on his wig of shoulder-length auburn curls for the day, and his shaven head was covered by a kind of nightcap or turban made of fur. While he was not at all perturbed to be seen in such obvious undress, the intimacy of it shamed and confused me, and I swiftly looked down and away from that pale triangle of his bare chest between his open shirt and gown. "You are Miss Jennings, aren't you?" he asked. "My wife's newest maid." The warnings I'd had from Lady Ainsworth and the others regarding the Duke rang an alarm in my head, and my one thought was to escape back to the other women.
"Yes, Your Grace," I said, as stiff as a block of alder wood. "I am Miss Jennings, your servant, Your Grace."
"More likely the Duchess's servant, eh?" He grinned, as if this were the greatest witticism imaginable, and took an idle step closer to me, blocking my way to the door. "She sends you to fetch her gloves." I looked down at the green kidskin gloves, trimmed with white fur, that were clutched tightly in my hand.
"Her Grace wishes to keep her hands warm."
"And what of yours, Miss Jennings? Weren't your little hands cold too?"
"I had my muff, Your Grace."
I held the muff up for him to see, pushed up over my wrist, as if somehow he would not have noticed it himself. I was inordinately proud of that muff, my first gift from Mary Beatrice, a narrow barrel of black-clipped beaver fur, luxuriously puffed inside with swan's down and lined with pink silk. My fingers were warm enough.
"Were they?"
He reached out and lightly stroked the muff's soft fur.
"What of the rest of you? Your arms, your thighs, your breasts. Is all of you as warm as it should be?"
I blushed, unable to mistake either his meaning or the suggestiveness of his caress, and I shifted the muff away from his touch.
"Yes, Your Grace."
"You know I wouldn't want you cold on account of my wife's whims. Perhaps you need a cloak lined in the same fur. You'd like that, wouldn't you?"
I swallowed hard, my heart thumping, and thought of how he wanted me to betray Mary Beatrice, laughing with her spaniels in the snow.
"Thank you, Your Grace," I said, "but I'm content with what I have."
"I cannot believe that. Ladies always wish for new baubles and fripperies, don't they?" He chucked me beneath the chin, forcing me to look up and meet his eye. "What a pretty little piece you are, Miss Jennings. What a joy it will be to have you in this household."
"Thank you,
Your Grace, I said, pulling my chin away.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.